I have a pronounced weakness for the kind of capital A art that Hollywood lifers tried in their youth and got called capital P pretentious for their trouble. I like when guys who write instruction manuals try to write poetry. I like the unwieldy and the obvious. I have a soft spot for the too muchness of Americans attempting to be Europeans. For novels written in crayon, for words tripped over with drunken tongues, things that seem to have been started with no idea what they mean or how they'll end. Castle Keep is one such folly, and I adore every awkward second of it. Every too proud turn of phrase from writers Daniel Teradash and David Raphael.
You find me degenerate, or worse, French.
Everything that aims for too cool and never ever hits the mark. Burt Lancaster leads a unit of bedraggled, wise-ass soldiers looking to sit out the last days of World War II in Jean-Pierre Aumont's castle. Scott Wilson and Peter Falk are among the grunts over whom he's got command. One of them wants to write.
These kind gentlemen rescued me from a slaver off of Santo Domingo. Went down with all hands. They thought they could learn Swahili from me.
Private Benjamin wants to be a writer, so he talks like a writer.
Private Benjamin thinks the war was invented so he could write a book about it.
One of them steals a dead man's family.
Beautiful. Where's the baker?
Gone.
That's what a man needs. Like his wife, kid, family, home.
One of them fucks a car.
I understand you've been sleeping with the Volkswagen.
Yes, sir. Is there regulation against it, sir?
Yes.
Sodomy?
That's animals. There's a regulation against using enemy equipment. Creates confusion.
Sir, she's a beautiful car, sir.
You must love the Volkswagen very much, Corporal Playboy.
The director is Sidney Pollack, a great actor, a born crowd pleaser, but no artist. And yet here's this big damn sculpture trying to pass itself off as paint on canvas. His great American novel just refusing to be great. I love it. Naturally, it's about beautiful things, enigmatic women and works of ancient art, and the question of whether they're destined to survive the whims of mankind, which tend to include war.
The Germans' first major objective will be to secure the hub of the road net in the Ardennes, this town, Bastogne. The easiest way to Bastogne is through Verviers, but they're not coming that way. Last night there were star shells over Saint Croix, you may have noticed. They lit the crossroads. It interests them. I just want to explain those star shells to you. It means this is the way they're coming. Right here, this castle. Any questions?
I thought the war was over.
That's not a question.
Sir, I think you ought to let the Indian express himself. Make him feel a part of the group.
Express yourself.
According to the book, the Germans couldn't move that many men without our intelligence knowing it.
That's right. Now you're part of the group.
I have a question. Germans counterattack. Wouldn't we be more valuable by pulling back to the Meuse River?
Saving the castle, the paintings, the sculpture has nothing to do with your strategy.
Frankly, yes, it does.
Well, that's a business about which I understand nothing. We're put here to service replacements. But there are no replacements. So we'll dig in just like real soldiers. I want the terraces mined, also the gardens.
Major Falconer. Meldore must not become a battleground.
Lancaster is the one-eyed adjudicator, trying to win the war his way by staying out of it, but knowing it'll find him eventually. It's a great film about seeking shelter, kind of a straight-faced version of Cabaret, sung by enlisted men.
In your room, come hear the music play. Life is a cabaret, old chum. Come to the cabaret.
Been tried before. Winning wars is for children, generals, and recruits. Get over that. Settle for a meal, for a drink, a lay, a house, a castle, a horse.
They have their pick of the corridors of heaven, but heaven's not forever. The film highlights how war, or any heightened condition or existence away from our routine, brings with it the demand for a new set of morals, a new design for life. Anyone who's been to a film festival, or been snowed in too long, or trapped in a house while plague claims hundreds of thousands of lives, knows what happens when the ordinary routine goes away and the outside world grows remote.
What's the matter with you, Lieutenant?
Most of us go mad. And wouldn't it be good to go mad beautifully, surrounded by the great works of art and the most beautiful people alive? Castle Keep is no kind of success, and yet it's exactly the kind of misbegotten curate's egg that only the overlap of a dying studio system and a new Hollywood wildness could have produced. Pollock was never anybody's easy rider. No maverick, no rule breaker, no cowboy. This half-thought-up trip was the closest he got to psychedelics and free love. Any closer and his wings would have melted. God bless Castle Keep, and every other pharmacist kid who tried to make Ulysses with Martin Ransohoff's money, or any other comparable and beautiful dare. Film history is littered with orphans and mutants just like this one. And that same history wouldn't be half as much fun without them.
I think I hear Rossi swimming. Do you hear him swimming, clear boy? He swims beautifully, doesn't he? He must have got up the wall when we weren't looking. Soon he'll drop the bridge. Will you feel strong enough to make it?
Sure. I've always followed you. Haven't I, Lieutenant?
There goes the bridge. We're home. Follow me, clear boy.
They both got up in the forest of dead roses and moved toward the stricken castle. They walked in staggered fine formation to the moat. The water was cool and clear, blue. They swam beautifully across the cold moat. They entered the castle and marched up the wide marble stairs, clear to the high lone turret on top, where they could see all the way home.